The power and beauty of the natural world is awe-inspiring. Beneath its form and structure, and beyond the cosmic forces which have shaped what we perceive in our sliver of time, lies complex and elusive forces rooted in the laws of physics itself. Mysteries which continue to inspire and perplex even the most brilliant amongst us. In the realm of musical understanding, my life's work, I've only personally encountered one such awe-inspiring, transcendent genius, a unique voice outside and beyond the norms of most musical brilliance I've seen, the composer, improviser, and uniquely virtuosic Aydin Esen. He's the topic of today's Everything Music. Watching are just some small clips of Aydin's musical evolution over the past 30 years. And these are just things that I have documented on video. There are many more audio recordings, obviously, that to listen to. But I wanted to give you a sense of the range, and it's really just a small sense of the range of Aydin's abilities as an improviser. Everything that you saw was completely improvised. Aydin is a master of so many genres of music: jazz, bebop, hard bop, modern jazz playing, modern classical music. He can read anything, synthesized music, any type of things with drum machine programming, and he has records out of soundscapes. He was doing this back when MIDI was just starting, back in the early 80s, when I met Aydin in 1984, MIDI had been out for a couple of years. He always had the earliest keyboards. In the first video you see there, he's playing a Kurzweil K250, which was the first sampling synthesizer. The very first clip in there is the first sampling synthesizer. As a matter of fact, Ray Kurzweil, that started Kurzweil, built the Kurzweil for Stevie Wonder. Well, their offices were just outside Boston, and one of my students at New England Conservatory, his dad was an investor in the company. So We had one. They donated one to New England Conservatory that Aydin would use down in the listening library. It was an $18,000, $19,000 keyboard, weighed 120 pounds. It had those string sounds on it. That's the first time we ever heard anything like that with a sampled piano, sampled orchestral sounds. Well, we went one day out to Kurzweil to see them and got to meet Ray Kurzweil, and Aydin played for Ray Kurzweil and Bob Moog. Bob Moog invented the synthesizer. So on the same day, we both met Bob Moog and Ray Kurzweil, and Aydin played for them in their little room that they had set up with a little stage, and they had a Kurzweil there, and they had all their new sound banks. And I remember Aydin brought his four-track and recorded the things that he improvised. He always recorded everything. Here's a little excerpt from a string quartet that he recorded with their new string quartet sound. Was just a minute or maybe 45 seconds of a 13-minute string quartet that I had improvised in front of Bob Moog and Ray Kurzweil. And that's also another piece that I played Dylan every day when he was a baby. It's really amazing that he could improvise things like this. I mean, he just heard the sound and just launched into it instantly. And that was just one of a number of pieces that he played right in a row back to back. I never heard him play anything like that again. Every clip that you see there at the beginning of this video, like the Alberti bass thing that he does in the very first thing with the really fast 32nd or 16th notes in the left hand, the arpeggiated chord figures. That's the only time I ever heard him do that, was that one time at that one concert. I never heard him play anything like that again. That's the amazing thing. Once Aydin would play something, he would just abandon it. He would just never play it again. That was his thing. It's like, yeah, okay, I've done that. It doesn't matter whether he did it when no one was there. Once he had played something, he never came back to it. It's astonishing. But I want to kind of talk about a couple things. First being that Aydin was actually the impetus for the idea of playing music for my son Dylan before he was born. I had this intense curiosity about what would happen if you played a baby Aydin's music. Would it sound normal to them? That was really the impetus for Nuryl, the listening program that I had developed for my kids. And Aydin's music in particular, what would a baby think of sounds like that when they hear this incredible, these melodic passages, these polytonal, bitonal, polymodal ideas. Like, what would that do to a baby? Would it sound like normal music? Would it sound like lullabies? And you've seen from the videos of Dylan the things that he's able to do. With his ear, and there's no question in my mind that it's from being immersed in Aydin's music from when he was a baby. As a matter of fact, the first piece that I played is in the video that I'll show you right here with Dylan listening to it when he's about 5 months old. So there you see Dylan as a baby, 5 months old, listening to Aydin's music. And it gave me my answer. What would happen if you play a baby high information music from the time that they're in utero till age two? is that they develop these really high functioning skills like Dylan has with his ear and his memory. I believe that the complexity and sophistication and the harmonic content of Aydin's music is what changed Dylan's brain. You know, I think I should first begin by telling you the story about how Aydin and I met. So it was the summer of 1984. I had just finished my undergraduate degree at Ithaca College, and I got into New England Conservatory in Boston. So I headed up to school about probably a week early or so, just to get acclimated to Boston. I had never lived there before. And I ended up getting an apartment with a friend of mine who was who got a job in Boston in Waltham, which is about 30 minutes outside. So it was a train ride. I would drive to the train and take the train in. So the first day I'm like, I'm going to go check out and see how long it takes to get to New England. So I look it up on the map and I get off at the Mass Ave stop. Well, the Mass Ave stop is the stop that's about 200 yards from the Berkeley building. So I figured I would go by Berkeley and check it out because it's two blocks away from New England. So I get off the train, I walk upstairs, and I start walking down the sidewalk. I can imagine it like it was yesterday. And across the street from Berkeley was a cafe that had about 30 people standing outside. And I could hear that there was music being played. So I start walking down, I cross the street. It's this place called Cafe Bouquet. So I cross the street, and I get closer, and I start hearing, oh, it's a jazz group. And I hear a saxophone player with a rhythm section. So I kind of inch my way in, I get into the cafe, I order something, and I'm listening to this, and I'm thinking, wow, this sax player is unbelievable. He's way better than anyone that I'd heard, and he was, you know, absolutely astoundingly good. He was looked like a teenager. I figured these are all Berkeley students. Well, his name was Donnie McCaslin, who's actually a really well-known jazz sax player now. But the thing that intrigued me the most was this keyboard player. So I look over and I see this guy and he's got this big head of hair. And it was Aydin. I didn't know who it was at the time, but he took a solo. And I was just stunned. I was mesmerized. I'd never heard anything like it. Never heard anyone improvise like this. And he was, you know, a young kid. He was my age. I mean, Aydin is we were both born in 1962. So he was 22 at the time. So I stood there and I watched him play about 7 or 8 tunes. And I was so shocked at what I saw. I just remember walking out of there and walking down to New England in a stupor and thinking, is that how people in Boston play? So I go to New England, I come back, the gig had ended, and I get back on the train and go back. And then I see my roommate Eric later that evening. And he says, hey, did you go into Boston today? I said, yeah, I did. And he said, how was it? I said, you're not going to believe this gig that I saw. It looked like a bunch of Berkeley students. And the sax player was unbelievably good, but this keyboard player blew my mind. I've never heard anyone play anything like this. And he said, who was he? I said, I have no idea. But I'm going to go find him tomorrow. So the next day, I get on the T, I head into Boston, 30 minutes, I get off the train stop, I walk to Berkeley. I figure, okay, he's got to be a Berkeley student, so I'm going to go walk around the practice rooms till I find him. So I start walking around, there's like hundreds of practice rooms in Berkeley, and I'm looking in every window. So finally, after about 15 minutes or so, I hear the sound, and I was like, okay, I know who that is. And it was a trio, and I looked in, I could see the back of his head with the big hair. And he was playing with bass player and drummer. And I waited till they were done with the tune, and I knock on the door. I walk in, they were just finishing up the rehearsal, and I said, hey, I went up to him and I said, how you doing? My name's Rick. I just gotta tell you, I saw you play yesterday and I was blown away. And he said, oh, cool, man, thanks. My name's Aydin. And I heard his accent, and I said, where are you from, Aydin? He said, I'm from Turkey. And we immediately hit it off, started talking, and ended up going out and having lunch together. And that was, you know, the first week of August in 1984. After that, he ended up finishing up at Berkeley, and he came to New England Conservatory the next semester, and we had classes together. We started playing gigs together. But Aydin wasn't like a regular student there. He had gone to Berkeley for a year. He got his 4-year degree. He tested out of every class. At New England, he was really teaching the composition teachers were studying with him. He'd hang out with them and they'd play him their pieces and get Aydin's reaction on them. He was just so far beyond anyone that was there at the time. 6 months later, I ended up getting an apartment in the same building Aydin lived in. He lived in this place called 20 Hemingway Street that a lot of the Berkeley people lived in. So I got an apartment with a bass player friend of his and a singer that lived one floor above Aydin. And every day you'd go into the building, there would be 10 people in front of Aydin's door listening through the door. That was just a thing. So I remember knocking on Aydin's door, and Aydin would come to the door, and he'd greet the people. He was always so polite and everything, and, hey, how you doing? Everybody, oh, hey, Aydin, we were just listening. Is that cool? And Aydin would be playing with his roommate, John, who was a drummer, Turkish drummer, John Kozlu. And they'd be playing together, or Aydin would be working on something, and they could hear the music through the door. So anyways, I'd go in, and every day Aydin would hang out, and he would be recording songs. He never practiced. The guy never practiced. I never saw Aydin practice one thing. You see all these technical things he can do? He could do those without ever practicing. And I said to him one time, I said, Aydin, how do you keep getting better without practicing? And he said, well, I practiced technique when I was 5 and 6. For the first 2 years in Turkey, so he went to Istanbul Conservatory from the time he was 5 until he was 18. His parents realized he had perfect pitch when he was 4. He went and got tested there, and then they got him into the conservatory. So I guess after school, he would go to the conservatory for 3 hours, and he studied piano, and he studied theory, all these different things, sight singing. Aydin is the greatest solfeggio you'll ever hear, and Aydin has the most amazing ear in the world. When people ask me about Dylan, I said, well, there's one person I know that has a better ear than Dylan, and it's Aydin. And Aydin can put all this musical knowledge along. He has the ear to hear all these polychords and everything because he plays all of them. And I remember one day in class, Aydin, we were in this class with George Russell, who wrote the Lydian chromatic concept of tonal organization. Aydin sat next to me in the class, and George would be playing stuff on the stereo. And Aydin would have staff paper. We all have staff paper, but Aydin would just, for fun, just notate anything that was being played. Right in real time, as fast as it was being played, Aydin would be writing 16th notes. He'd be rewriting all the rhythms, everything. And the thing would be done playing, and Aydin would just keep writing because he remembered everything that he heard. It didn't matter how dense it was. He could write out the full orchestral score. I've never seen anything like it. The guy could listen to an orchestral score and just write it down. No problem. He never even thought about it. I found this little clip of when he was here at my studio recording in 2015, I found this little clip of him listening to a tune, and it's just a really short little clip of him figuring out the changes of this tune, and you'll see him instantly play the chords once they are, and these are really dense polychords. Check this out. As you can see, it's just a split second and he's on it. It's like Dylan when he's naming the chords, but Aydin can put them under his fingers instantly. Doesn't matter how many notes they are, doesn't matter what kind of chord it is. He instantly knew. Which is why when I showed Aydin the first videos of Dylan before I made any of the videos that had gone viral, Aydin saw that and he knew that Dylan could recognize his vocabulary. By playing a baby Aydin's music, it connected all these concepts together. And when you see Dylan's ear and you listen to Aydin's music, his improvisations, all those unexpected twists, all the intense harmonic content with them, it starts to make sense that Dylan can hear these kind of clusters and harmonies and polychords and things like that. It all of a sudden makes sense. Oh, he grew up on the language of Aydin Esen. So when Aydin and I were hanging out every day at his place in 85 and 86, he'd be recording in his four-track all the time, be writing tunes. He would be doing them with the synthesizers. These were like fusion tunes with amazing chord changes and everything. And there's one in particular that had the most incredibly great solo in it. I'll play it for you here, but I remember when Aydin did the solo, he would do solos. He'd like, hey, just hit play and record. And then he'd just do one pass, and that was the solo. That'd be it. And I'd have to quickly punch out and stuff. And he would record all these things. He had a little drum machine. I forget what he had, like an old Yamaha drum machine. This is, you know, this is primitive stuff. But the this is on one of his tunes, and check it out. I just think that's an unbelievably great solo, and the chord changes are really so unusual, so hip. So over the course of those couple years together, from 84 to the beginning of 87, we played a lot of gigs together. Aydin played a ton of gigs on his own and with other players, mostly in trios or quartets. And a few times we got to play with Vinny Caliuta. Vinny was friends with my roommate Rob, who was a bass player that Rob had played bass with him out in L.A., and Vinny called our apartment one time, and he says, you know who that was on the phone? I said, no. He goes, that was Vinny Caliuta. I said, you know Vinny Caliuta? He said, yeah, I used to play with him out in L.A. So Vinny came out and played with our group. It was me and Aydin and Rob and Vinny. Vinny flies in. We had charts that he read, and he had a music stand up there, and Vinny's known for his reading skills. Any of you know that know Vinny's drumming. He played with Frank Zappa. He's like the master of polyrhythms, And he's just one of the most amazing drummers in the world. So anyways, this next thing I'm going to play is a little part of a tune with basically Vinny and Aydin soloing together. And you can hear some of the polyrhythms that Vinny's playing. And Aydin is just playing this ridiculous synth solo over it. But this fusion, essentially. But check it out. I want you to hear this. So it was not long after that gig that both Aydin and I finished up at New England, and I ended up getting a job offer teaching back at Ithaca College, where I'd done my undergrad, as some of you know from one of my other videos. So I headed off to Ithaca in the spring of 87, and I wasn't going to start teaching till the fall, so I went and moved into the town, and one of the first things I did was with my buddy Tom Verrier. Tom set up a gig for Aydin, a master class at Ithaca. And this was a master class for anybody that wanted to come, but the entire faculty and all the students came, and they heard about Aydin. We rented this sampling synthesizer, the Kurzweil. No one had ever seen a sampling synthesizer before. One of the early clips is Aydin playing with one of the string sounds, but he played this, did a master class. He answered questions, and it was really fascinating. But one of the really interesting things from it, the pieces were amazing, but one of the interesting things is during the master class, he was demonstrating something, and it reminded him. He said, you know, one good thing to do is to practice with one note at the top of a chord and see how many harmonies you can play on it. So here's an example that Aydin gave at the master class.
C note. You can just do that sometimes. It's really good practice. You just take C note and play it as many as harmonies you can play on it. Say.
So that was April 23rd, 1987. I remember that because I just found a poster for it. So the next year in September or August, I started teaching full-time at Ithaca. And one of the things that I did is I brought Aydin back in October of that year to do some improvisations and teach some private lessons to my students that were interested in that had seen him the year before. So we rented a Kurzweil again. And we recorded all day one day where Aydin just played piece after piece after piece. And we recorded it. We videotaped it all because we knew it was important to capture this stuff. And the next day he taught lessons all day. And in one of the lessons he was showing this piano player how to play over one chord and doing this modal mixture where you change modes every two beats. And I have the example from that lesson on one of my earlier videos. It's called Meldau, Baron, and Essen, and I have that transcribed. But right after that, I remember I was going to get some coffee, and Aydin started playing an improvisation just on a C pedal. And I left the room, and I came back about 15 minutes later, and he was still playing it. Here's a little excerpt from this C pedal improv, and it's pretty astounding when you realize that he's just playing octaves with his left hand and the other thing. It sounds like two lines are going on at the same time, but it's all played with his right hand. The end of October, so 6 weeks later he was back again. That's where he played that first piece from here with the Alberti bass. That was at the Women's Community Building in Ithaca. And we would get, you know, 200 people to these shows. It's amazing to see an hour and a half, 2 hour live improvisation by Aydin. You know, this was just an amazing concert, and there was a really fascinating interview that two good friends of mine, Pat Ryan and Rick Harth, did after the show was over. They interviewed Aydin, and I'm going to give you a little excerpt from that interview.
It really seems that you developed your own approach and your own sound, and that it's all rooted in a real love for music, first and foremost.
I worked on it. I'm putting it together. It might take years more, but, you know, I'm trying to put my own thing together, and I've been working on it a long time.
You said today, after giving a lot of lessons, that you were learning a lot of things after giving lessons.
I always do. I love giving lessons because I always learn. I can't come up with something, and then I work on it, and then student start working, we work on it, and I learn something, student. Well, a lot of times I give the lesson and I learn a lot more than student do, because some people just don't know how to learn. So it's like a learning thing, you know. You can always learn every second. You can really develop that.
How do you decide what's beautiful in music? Do you hear it immediately, or do you think about it for a while? Do you have a feeling in your body that something is beautiful to you, or do you feel that it's more intellectual for you?
Yeah, that's a good question. That's what I've been working on all my life, being really tasty and playing the right things at the right spot. But there are no rules for that. Yeah, we can come up with hundreds of rules, harmony, you know, as you know, like, you know, how to harmonize, how to, you know, compose and all this stuff. But I mean, that's exactly what I've been working on for years, being the putting the notes the right spots, you know, like building up, making up a piece, form, texture, timbre, everything. I think about all these things, but I'm just trying to get close to it. That's my goal, close to, you know, I mean, nobody is really perfect, but you can get really close to it, I think. I mean, I can say sometimes, but actually the levels are the same. My playing and writing levels you know, say like a lot of paper composers that I know, they write and they can't really play because they're not player. So that's the actually harder for me because I'm playing and writing. So if I write, I don't know, I'm gonna have to play it. I'm gonna wanna play it. So, but technically I don't really have problems with that. I can play almost anything on piano, just if it's written or if it's not written, I can imagine it too. So, since the levels are the same, I can just, it's just a matter of what I wanna really, if I'm writing something, if I want really different, something really different from what I play, I can just go ahead and write it.
So after that December concert, Aydin came back to Ithaca three more times. One was on February 21st of 88, and then March 31st of 88, we did a concert in Binghamton that we promoted that Aydin played solo. And then the next year, at the end, or that same year, at the end of the year, in December, he came and was the guest soloist with the Ithaca College Jazz Ensemble. And after that, Aydin never came back to Ithaca. He ended up going to Paris and winning the World Jazz Piano Competition in Paris in 1989. I'd like to play you part of one of the pieces from that competition. Jazz Piano Competition, Aydin, during that same year, recorded a record, a trio record, with Peter Herbert on bass and John Koslow, his old roommate, on drums. And eventually, around, I believe it was 1991, got signed by Columbia Records and did a record called Anadolu that came out. It was a 12 or 14 song record and came out of Columbia Records. And they didn't know what to do with it because it was straddling the world of jazz and modern classical music. I mean, there were some pieces on it that were obviously classical pieces. And he had some players like Dave Holland played bass on it. So did Anthony Jackson. And he had, I think, Peter Erskine on it. And Dave Liebman played saxophone. He had, you know, had full horn section and full rhythm section. Right after that, he and his wife Randy had their first child, Icon. I remember going to his record release party at the Blue Note for his Columbia record, and he kept touring around for the next year or so. He was living in the city, and I was living in the East Village on First Ave in St. Mark's as before I moved to Atlanta. And then I lost touch with him. They moved back to Turkey, and I didn't hear from Aydin for years. I mean, I would get occasional letters from him, or I'd hear about him from friends that had been over touring Europe when Aydin was playing there, but I saw very few records that came out. I knew he was releasing records, but it was very difficult in the 90s to keep track of people. And honestly, the next time I talked to Aydin was in 2011 when we did a Skype. This is after Dylan had been born. This is after I had played Aydin's music for Dylan for years, and I remember doing the Skype, and once we had email, we would keep up with each other via email more, but we did the Skype, and I remember Aydin asking me, so are your kids into music? Is your son Dylan into music? And I said, oh, let me send you a little video. So I sent him a video of one of my YouTube videos. It's still on my channel from back then, and Dylan is naming notes and chords, and it blew Aydin's mind to see him doing this. He called his wife Randy in. He's, Randy, you gotta come in to see this. And then the next thing I wanted to do was to figure out how to get Aydin to come here. And it wasn't until we started my company Nuryl that that we brought Aydin back over here to do some recording in 2015. So that was literally the next time I saw him. So I ended up not seeing Aydin from 1993 until 2015. So 22 years I went without seeing one of my closest friends. And I remember when he showed up here at the airport, I thought, man, Aydin's gonna not recognize me. I've got gray hair. But when I saw him, he looked the same still. Here's us meeting each other at the airport.
Hi. You know what I mean.
The man!
Looks like you.
So we caught up on the drive back from the airport to my place, and then Aydin came in to meet my wife Nina and the kids. And that was really a fun experience because my kids all knew who he was. They had been listening to his records their whole lives. I think for Dylan especially, because he was the oldest and really knew Aydin through his music and had watched videos of him, and he was as excited as Aydin was to meet him. Dylan was really excited. Here's a picture of them together, first time meeting. This was amazing for me as well. After we hung out with the kids upstairs, Aydin and I came down to the studio, and the first thing he did is he walks in the door and he sees my pump organ sitting right next to the door, and he sits down on it and starts playing. Now my pump organ is a perfect quarter step sharp. And the only two people with perfect pitch that it doesn't bother are Dylan and Aydin. So Aydin sits down and starts playing it, and he just loved it. Here's a little clip from that. So we set up and start recording. He told me that he hadn't touched a piano in 3 weeks because he had been on vacation with his wife and his son, Cenk, in Italy. And he sat down to warm up at the piano. Here's a little bit of his warm up. We ended up recording for about 6 days or so. On the first day alone, Aydin improvised, I think, some 29 different pieces, including a whole series of modal pieces, just short 1 minute pieces that are some of my favorite things that he's done. One of the pieces, I get asked all the time what it is, and it's actually from that first day. And I use it a lot for my YouTube Live and my Facebook Live videos as my intro music. You'll recognize it, I think, if you've watched any of them. So for those of you that were wondering when I was going to finally do this episode on Aydin, here it is. This was a really difficult one to talk about because it's a hard story to tell because it goes over the course of 33 years. And then there's this big period of time, 22 of those years, where I didn't see Aydin at all. And he's had an enormous impact on me as a musician, and obviously my children have grown through listening to his music, and the idea that Aydin isn't a household name to me is just unbelievable. And if there's any justice in the world, Aydin will eventually be a household name. But he is the greatest improviser I've ever heard. And I hope that you will share his music and his story with people. That's all for now. Please subscribe here to my Everything Music YouTube channel, and thank you for watching.